Welcome to Qt Widgets and More. In this week's episode, we'll proceed improving on the custom context menu actions that we did last week. It'll be much easier to use from the user end. There is a few C++ tricks in there. Might not be new to you, but who knows? Better watch to be sure. So last week, we created this framework for context menus that allowed you to modify the title of the menus based on the item that you selected on, and which allowed you a number of other facilities. And you can, for example, see right here where I can right click. And last week we saw that it said negate one. I could paint, I could make it red here. And this action was enabled. Well, actually the negate action is not enabled when multiple cells were selected. And that's what we talked about last week. If you haven't watched that episode, no, I'm not gonna give you the URL. Go and find it yourself. You deserve watching all those kitten videos because you fall over them while you're searching for that video. But once you're back, let's continue. Welcome back from your kitten hunting. Last week, we saw that there was a class called Qt Widgets and More Table View. And we didn't go into details there, but you can imagine that it's subclassed from Qt Table View to provide the additional facilities. And one of those were the method called add context menu action, which was a method that we called to add our entries into the context menu. Had you looked a bit further in the source code last week, you'll have noticed that there was also a Qt Widgets and More tree view that was subclassing from Qt tree view, and which also had this add context menu action. You likely would stop following these videos had I taken the code for add context menu action and copied and pasted that into both of these classes. What you would expect was that I subclass from a class that had that method, and exactly what I did. Also, I need to bring up that menu whenever the user right clicks. I bring up that menu by overriding the context menu event method whenever the user right click. That method is get called, and I override that one. But how is that working now? If I subclass from QTableView and I subclass from my adapter, and my adapter implements that method, that doesn't override the method from QTableView. It doesn't. But if you do not subclass directly, but you use a bit of template, you can actually make a subclass. And that's the code that you see right up here now. Let me just show you. Qt Widgets and More tree view is subclassing from context menu adapter with the template parameter of Qt tree view. What's that about? Well, let's look at the context menu adapter. The context menu adapter, which is a superclass, go back here. It's a superclass of Qt Widgets and More. That's a context menu adapter. That one itself subclass from the parameter given in here. And that way I can get my override of the context menu event. As you can see right here, context menu event is now overriding the one in the superclass, which is view, which is your Qt tree view. So that way I can sneak in that override method or overridden method. And sure, if you are a C++ template expert, I did not tell you anything, but at least personally, it has only been within the last year or so that I got to think about this trick. I used it some episodes back, but hey, I thought it would be worthwhile, a minute and 27 seconds of your time to see that trick again. You might actually need it one day yourself. So that was the first of the two things I wanted to show you. And the second actually comes with two philosophic advices for life. Are you ready? Number one, if you ever spend a day or even more polishing some code to make it better, and the result is only marginal better than the previous version, don't blame yourself. You're not going to get anything out of that. Just enjoy the new result and say, well, sometimes meep happens. That was number one. Number two is sometimes you need to question your own fundamental understanding of how things are. And I'll show you how I had to question that myself. But let's first look at the code that we're talking about. It looks like this right above my head here. It is the adding an action to our context menu as we saw last week. I have this negate action, and the negate action I created here using make unique, and it's an action that I make into a unique. And the whole idea about this make unique is that I have this hierarchy of action base at the top, subclassed into action and into separator and into queue action action, which we didn't talk about, and into other actions in my own code base. I have a hierarchy, and therefore I cannot just give it I need a list of these, so I could not have a queue vector of action base, because then I would be slicing my items. But I can have a queue vector of action pointers, but I don't like pointers, because what's the ownership? Therefore, it's a vector of my unique pointers around actions. Okay. So far, so good. What I really want, I'm not gonna sing that song again for you. We did that in an earlier episode, and there was lots of complaints about that. What I want is, instead of all this unique pointers, blah, 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 I would like to just write action, just the name of the class here, and specify the parameter, and then write view, add context menu, and then the action. But Jesper, have you not been paying any attention the last 30 years of object-oriented programming? Have you not ever heard about slicing? If you specify that, and wait, you're giving... What parameter does add context menu action take? And that's where I'll turn around and say, well, Jesper, haven't you paid any attention over the last few years where we're trying to get away from all these pointers and get into the land of value classes? And there might be pointers, but they are behind the scenes. And I'm personally reading about type erasure, pretty interesting and hairy stuff. And that is doing exactly that. So I thought to myself, maybe I can do something similar. And let me show you the surprising, for me at least, implementation of add context menu action now. So last week's episode of add context menu action looks like this. It took a unique pointer to this action base, and it pushed that onto my action. That's a classical one. You didn't take a pointer, you took a unique pointer, you moved the unique pointer over, and it got into that list. Now, this week uses templates. So it took a template type name T, and that's where you go like, yes, bro, what's going on here? Well, the template, the type T here is actually an action or a separator or a queue action action or whatever subclass of my usual action base, blah, 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 blah. It takes that as a value, and that value is pushed onto my stack after it has made a copy of it. That's the sound of my head, at least, when I needed to wrap my head around this. What I really wanted was to give a value over and put that value on the list. But my value was in this class hierarchy. And I've learned since I was this big that I should not take by value something from a class hierarchy, because then I would have the slicing problem. But here I actually take it by value, but wrapped in a template. So now it's actually not a action-based value I take over there. It's actually the value of a action, so the subclass. And that one I make a copy of here. So I make a copy allocated on the heap, and that is pushed onto my action. So I still have the class hierarchy. I still have this list of unique pointers, but it's entirely hidden from the user of this class. And yes, if in production you have the ability of hearts, red hearts flying around, now would be a good time to do that. I really love this. Finally, over here in my main.cpp, please look at this code here. Previously, I wrote view add context menu actions stood make unique separator paint. That was for adding a separator for the submenu paint. Now I just add context menu separator paint. One, two, not that many characters that I saved. So I'll go back to my own advice. Just enjoy the solution. And yes, I didn't save the world with this change, but anything I do that makes my code more readable, makes it more maintainable, means that I'll make fewer bugs in the future. So I hope you enjoyed this episode. Let me go full screen while I say that. I hope you enjoyed this episode of Qt Widgets and More. For me, it was a gigantic leap from a belief that I must never ever provide an instance of a class to a function if that class is part of a class hierarchy. So that, well, maybe if I add this template, then I can, because I can still go back from the template into the class hierarchy. And that was a gigantic change for me. And I'll definitely be learning more. And I'm sure you'll see some episodes on my new, well, I haven't learned it really yet, but type erasure is one of those things that I'm currently practicing. And that is where the idea came from. Until next time, have a great time.